All Hallows Eve, that time of year again. All creatures from beneath are unleashed to the world. It's time to return to where we all started. Another year, but the scares continue. Another month, but the fear proceeds to rise. This is the Venom Month of Horrors 2, the quest for Shet.
Hello and welcome to the second annual Venom Month of Horrors. Another year, and it doesn't get any less scary. And today, let's talk about Jigsaw. Released in 2004, Saw really blew up the horror genre forever, and I firmly believe it deserves to be in the 1001 movies you must see before you die. Starting as a short film which slowly expanded to a feature with a low budget, primarily shot in just one bathroom, it tells the story of two men, one of which played by Cary Elwes, waking up chained to a pipe, receiving threatening audio recordings from the perpetrator John Kramer, aka Jigsaw, played by Tobin Bell, who's inserted them into a demonic game of clues. John is a cancer patient who feels like others don't appreciate life enough, so he set out to make them fight for theirs. Both men have done wrong and need to amend their actions. Clues are along the way with lots of twists and turns. We're following a criminal the entire movie who we believe is the killer before Elwes' character Dr. Gordon manages to cut his foot off and escape, before the famous twist that John was the corpse in the room the entire time. Not only did it blow up horror and the whole one location aspect, but it brought back the plot twist element to scary films, and Jigsaw almost instantly became an iconic character. And you know, everyone makes fun of Lee Whannell's acting for being so bad, but no one has the balls to admit that Cary Elwes was possibly worse.
Why didn't you show me this before?
He was pretty bad. Naturally, it was a big hit, and just 1 year later, we got Saw 2. Donnie Wahlberg was brought in, weirdly being called
Eric Matthews.
Hello, I'm Eric Matthews.
This one focused more on John's backstory, which is why I really dig it. A lot of the movie is Wahlberg talking to him while the players in the game roam around a poisoned funhouse of death traps, one of which being Wahlberg's son, and another being Amanda, who survived the first film, but then there's two amazing plot twists, one of which has Amanda joining forces with John to help him with his work. I actually prefer this film to the original, but then the series kinda took a dive. Saw 3 had John on the verge of death as Amanda forces a nurse to remove his tumor while a game is taking place, and it was this one that began to focus more on grossing out the audience rather than telling a creative and compelling story, but I still enjoy it. I enjoy all of them to an extent, but then the series became a parody of itself. Weirdly, John was killed off, so I can only assume they wanted it to end as a trilogy, but that didn't stop them from making more. Saw 4 came, and it became more of a season of CSI than a horror franchise. Instead of creative traps, it was just gore, and they messed with timelines, having 3 and 4 taking place simultaneously, and then it turned out a detective called Hoffman was also helping John this entire time. Then Saw 5 and 6 happened, also at the same time, with weird flashbacks to keep Tobin Bell in it, but the writers kinda lost sight of what Jigsaw was all about. The character gave people a choice and a chance of redemption, but then the traps began having innocent people involved who had no choice and were just bound to die anyway. Sometimes they sidestepped it by saying Amanda or Hoffman set it up and rigged it, which led to Jigsaw punishing or killing them, but other times it actually is Jigsaw, which just made no sense. Saw 6's entire game is based on the guy who refused to give John his cancer treatment, and after he goes through the entire thing, goes through absolute hell, it's not even his game and he dies anyway. So literally, what was the entire point of the whole movie? It just seemed like they forgot the point of the character, and weirdly, this one is actually held in high regard by fans of the entire series. Saw 7 at least tried something else with a meta style, as Jigsaw was praised as this iconic killer before Dr. Gordon returns and gives us the most predictable plot twist in history. He's been nowhere to be seen for the past 6 movies, then he appears right at the start of this one escaping. Fine, whatever. But then we have this meeting of Saw survivors and...
I'm sure I speak for everyone here when I say how grateful we are to be part of your promotional DVD.
Gee, I wonder what's going to happen. Oh, what a shock. Dr. Gordon was also helping Jigsaw the entire time. So we had Amanda Hoffman and Dr. Gordon. How many apprentices can this guy have? But this was supposed to be the end of the series. It was originally going to be split into 2 parts, but Saw 6 failed at the box office, so this one was just left on its own, but it was now supposed to be the end. Saw actually held the record for being the most consistent horror franchise in history, having a film come out every year for 7 years straight. But that was going to be the end. But it never really is the end with horror, is it? Due to the change of the Saw 7 two-parter idea, the writers felt like the twist of Dr. Gordon was confusing and left more questions unanswered. They had ideas for more, but refused to give anything away at the time in case another movie did in fact materialise.
Which, by the way, this movie doesn't actually answer anything to do with Dr. Gordon, but you know.
The studio refused any ideas pitched until they heard one that they felt was worth bringing the series back.
Really? This is the one that convinced them?
Writers Josh Stolberg and Peter Goldfinger spent 2 years coming up with this idea and claimed they would reinvent the franchise. It was said to be a fresh take on the material that will establish a new storyline to catch the series in the future with lots of interesting twists.
Really?
This film? After so many years out of the spotlight, Saw fans were wondering what could be done differently and if Jigsaw himself would actually be alive again. Tobin Bell was confirmed to appear, and the trailers all made it look like John was back from the dead somehow, which was the entire selling point of the film, which smashed $103 million against a budget of just $10 million, making it a huge success. To the point the studio officially greenlit a Saw 9 and 10. Well, let's see just how much they could disappoint, because honestly, when those trailers dropped, I was pumped. This is Jigsaw. So we open a Saw movie with a car chase.
Okay, that's different.
Where Colin Farrell's understudy is on the run being cornered on a rooftop.
On the ground! Drop him right now!
Detective Halloran! Detective Halloran!
He's not here! It's 17 minutes! Five people are gonna die!
Oh hey, it's the writers of Saw 6!
Doesn't he know?
All of you, get back.
Halloran!
Edgar! Edgar, what the fuck are you doing? You put down that remote.
I can't.
What's that for?
Games are just getting started.
Why do they always speak so vaguely? Why not just, hey, by the way, Jigsaw's alive, come and help me, he's back! And he chooses to save himself, but he gets shot anyway, so... This was kind of pointless, what the hell did the dude expect? Anyway, he had some kind of detonator, but someone deliberately shot him in the chest, which everyone denies. So obviously someone elsewhere sniped him. Oh, one of the twists and turns just predicted in the first 2 minutes. And this sets off the main game, where these five arseholes are all wearing chum bucket helmets from SpongeBob for some reason, and they wake up tied to a blade across the room, except one douchebag who I guess is narcoleptic. You know, this trap, I can't help but think we've already seen this somewhere before. Isn't it basically the opening trap from Saw 5? Fresh new material, guys! Fresh new material!
Jesus.
Of course, Jigsaw's voice bellows out that they all need to confess their lies, but in this particular trap, it's all very simple.
I want to play a game.
Fuck you!
First, an offering of blood, no matter how little, will give you a green light to escape from this room with your lives.
So why is there any conflict? He just told you you need to bleed no matter how little. Well, just bite your finger. As long as you bleed, you're free. He just told you what to do. Why is this difficult?
Can't be.
But this movie is stupid, so they all start to get dragged towards death because they're too stupid to realize Jigsaw just told them exactly what to do. Eventually, one woman does it and it works, so they all follow suit except the world's heaviest sleeper. So he gets completely mutilated, but it's not very important, ignore him. Meanwhile, the cops watch over Colin Farrell Jr. as he's now in a coma.
Doc, we need him awake, we've got questions.
I don't think they understand how comas work.
What do you want with us?
To use you to make money off of a shitty ass sequel. So the douchebags start to introduce themselves and realise that they need to cleanse their souls by confessing to just how horrible they are. But who cares about that? This bird is out for a run when she spots... Okay, in all seriousness, that shot is fucking amazing. But enough of that, let's cut to this dude with his daughter playing catch because we don't have quite enough characters just yet. This is Logan. He used to be a doctor and is also a war veteran, but his wife was murdered a few years ago by the dude from the start of the film. They take him along... for... some reason. Seriously, there's no reason.
Where was that, sweetheart?
To the coroners to investigate the corpse of Sleepy McSleeperson. They remove the chum bucket helmet to see that he's actually the ghost from Beetlejuice.
Someone's been studying up on John Kramer. Copycat?
Hope not. Kramer's been dead for 10 years.
Well, yeah. That'd be why he'd be a copycat. What'd you hope not? What?
And inside the jigsaw piece, there's a USB stick, because of course there is! They find Kramer's voice on there, setting up the game and promising to kill again, which is admittedly kinda cool.
The games have begun again, and they will not stop until the sins against the innocent are atoned for.
They take the recording off for voice recognition, while elsewhere the jigsaw puppet finally returns for its mandatory cameo.
No, it's not creepy at all.
Okay, that was funny.
Also, isn't this whole thing about confessing just kind of ripping off Unfriended's whole shtick? It's the same thing! The villain's forcing them to admit how horrible they are. This is Unfriended!
Bullshit.
But it's a race against time as they get dragged further closer to death. The black kid, called Mitch, admits that he sold a motorbike to a man who died not long after. The woman, Anna, claims that she lost a baby and her husband was unfairly blamed for it. But all of this is rather pointless as Mitch says screw it and grabs the tape, releasing them all anyway.
Huh. Pointless.
As far as we know.
So Jigsaw claims that one of them stole someone's purse.
Oh, send him to the chair!
But the victim actually suffered an asthma attack and the criminal decided to ditch them.
Oh. Okay, yeah, screw him.
So basically, whoever this criminal was poisoned as they slept. There's three syringes, one has an antidote, one has acid, and the other basically kills them all, I think. They're also on a timer to make the decision, but it doesn't matter because still nobody wants to confess despite their lives being at stake. Yeah, I think your life is more important than your morals right now.
Oh, shit.
But one woman is guilty and realizes the syringes all have codes on them. She notices that one is the precise amount of money that she stole, but for some reason still doesn't know which one to choose. Oh look, this code is the exact amount of money I stole from that woman that he's having a go at me for. Coincidence, that doesn't mean anything. Which one do I choose?
What the hell?
They start being dragged to the ceiling before Douchebag, who's called Ryan by the way, but we'll call him Douchebag because he's a douchebag, stabs all three of them into her at once, saving them all as the acid takes over and kills her, which is actually quite gruesome. Which one was right? She should have hurried her ass up. He just saved your lives.
I just saved our lives.
See? Meanwhile, the others identify the chum bucket guy as Malcolm. No, I wish. His wife was murdered a while back and he was forced to watch. They're also informed that the voice recognition came back as none other than...
Voice was John Kramer. Matched.
Identical.
Matched.
What? You came back from the dead?
Wouldn't be his first time.
Okay, at least they're self-aware.
So as the group enter the next area, they don't seem to have any idea who Jigsaw is, which already gives the twist away!
Who's doing this to us?
I have no idea.
In every other film, more or less, Jigsaw is a renowned serial killer, but here they haven't got a clue, so way to spoil your own damn twist! Yeah, lots of twists and turns in this one, fresh new material!
Okay.
So Douchebag confesses to unpaid mortgages, cheating on taxes and wives, but that's pretty much it. Anna claims her husband rolled over and suffocated their baby by accident. Wonderful. Douchebag grabs a shovel and ignores the blatant no exit sign, but what a surprise, he falls through the floor and his leg is caught up in some tight ass wires before Mitch spots the audio tape.
Man, Jigsaw needs to upgrade to iPod.
Too late.
Mitch tries to reach it with a rake, but it breaks before using his bare hand, and admittedly the suspense is actually built quite well. But all the tape says is to pull the handle to release Douchebag. Which they already knew!
Kinda pointless.
It's beautiful, isn't it?
They decide to leave him to it as they head inside some cylinder thing where a TV appears. Basically, Mitch and Anna are gonna be buried alive in grain unless Douchebag frees himself and them in the process.
There is, however, one person who can help you. Ryan. If he pulls the lever before you're buried alive, you will live. Ryan. Free yourself. To free them.
So much of this makes no sense. It makes my head hurt. How would Jigsaw possibly know that anyone would try the no exit door? Or that it would be Ryan specifically? He says his name as if this is a live feed, but we find out later as well, it's all pre-done beforehand. How would he know Ryan would try the door? How would he know Ryan would fall through? And how would he know that Ryan wouldn't have already freed himself by the time Mitch and Anna got into the next room? These writers are the ones who convinced the studio to bring this series back?
Oh my god.
Meanwhile, this coroner bird gets interrogated because, of course, the copycat has to be one of these people involved. It turns out there's a website dedicated to Jigsaw and all of his fans, and she's one of them. Furthermore, they even find DNA under the victim's nail, and it belongs to...
John Kramer.
What? That's impossible.
That's a fact. The blood under the fingernails of our first victim, it's John Kramer's blood. The Jigsaw killer.
Dun, dun, dun! Now, for real, that was actually one of the things that sold me in the trailers.
Maybe you deserve it.
So Douchebag is quite reluctant to lose a leg. So he's just gonna sit there trapped forever. Before pitchforks and all sorts of weapons start falling down, because apparently being buried alive isn't quite scary enough already. In fact, isn't this a barn? Made of wood? Can't you just use those tools to escape?
That's impossible.
Anyway, Douchebag does eventually sacrifice his own leg. And then Anna nearly dies immediately after. That would have been hilarious. But the public are now under the impression that John is somehow still alive. While Logan and his jigsaw-obsessed bird, whose name isn't really important, try to give each other an interesting backstory, but it doesn't really work. She has some job or something in Cleveland, but is this really supposed to be more interesting than Jigsaw coming back to life? Oh well, she apparently has a sore shrine and he convinces her to show him it, but look, they're being followed. Ooh. And I am not joking. She has a goddamn Jigsaw playhouse. This is mortifying. How would she even get any of this stuff? And FYI, for future reference, she's actually completely innocent in this film. Well, until the sequels make her apprentice number 98.
I confess that this is fucked up!
But for now, she's completely innocent and she has all of these torture devices at her disposal. She apparently also has a trap that Jigsaw designed but never got to use, though she believes he did use it, but the bodies were never discovered. So she has this trap how? And knows about it how? Oh well, the black cop takes pictures.
Cool.
Meanwhile, the dude wakes up from his coma. And now we're back with Mitch and Anna tending to Douchebag's leg. Okay. Wait, and then we're back to Logan. But look, he has scars all over his back. Ooh, it's dramatic for some reason. Oh, also the commissioner wants to calm the public's nerves by showing Kramer's corpse to the world. I'm sure Logan Paul has it somewhere. Back in the game, we learn that Mitch actually knew the motorbike's brakes were faulty and he still sold it to the guy who died, and it just so happened to be John's nephew. But how the hell would Jigsaw know this? There's no witnesses! What, did Mitch just go around telling his friends, oh, I knew those brakes were faulty and then he died? Ha ha, lol, what am I like? How would he know any of this? And how does Jigsaw seemingly know everybody in the entire world? He knows everyone, everyone in these traps he has some kind of connection with. Oh well, Mitch gets completely mutilated, which I must admit I did not see coming. And that was hilarious. So they dig up John's grave, but whoop, it has the guy from the coma in it instead. Somehow. I mean, how the hell did the killer manage to get the body there that quickly and undetected? In fact, wouldn't the cops have noticed that the grave was recently dug up before they started? And what the hell were they expecting to find anyway? He's been dead 10 years. Oh, look, a decomposing skeleton. That's definitely John Kramer.
How horrible.
So the cops investigate the Jigsaw funhouse, even finding loads of newspaper clippings about John, before arresting Logan for the crimes, but he backtracks and blames the detective. He lists all these pieces of evidence from the previous scenes to make it look obvious that it's the detective, which in turn makes the goddamn plot twist at the end more blatant to see! What the hell? You've just given away your own twist, and these douchebags are like, loads of twists and turns, new material, screw you!
No.
Meanwhile, the Saw fan shows up and claims she knows where the game is being played and she wants to go and save the day. That makes no sense based on the obvious twist, but yeah, we'll come back to this.
Good luck, Lollipop.
Back at the game, Anna tries to break out, wedges the door ajar and decides that in a goddamn saw trap, it's a pretty good idea to crawl through it. But what a shock, someone shows up and sedates her. She wakes up, as does Douchebag, both chained to a wall, and we see...
Okay, John's reveal is actually expertly done. Based on the twist, she doesn't give it away, she just looks confused and recognises him. His appearance is badass. This is actually really handled well.
I'm trying, dude!
So John reveals that Douchebag was actually a reckless youth who ended up killing three people in a car crash and blamed the drivers.
Again, how would he know this when there's no witnesses and he lied? Is he telepathic?
He also reveals that the doctors messed up his scan results, which is why the cancer took its toll so quickly, as they didn't discover the truth before it was too late, which is actually quite an interesting new addition, so I guess that's one thing they added. And of course, as explained, John knows everyone in the damn world, so he also knows Anna. She was his neighbour and he witnessed her marriage collapsing. It turns out that she's mates with my ex-wife and she couldn't handle the baby crying, so she killed it and framed her husband.
How would he know this? They make it out because he's next door, he hears the baby crying, he hears her saying shut up. What? So her, like, the sound of her suffocating the baby couldn't have been the husband rolling over and killing the baby. How would he know it from sounds? And these characters are awful. They have no redeeming qualities. Why should we want any of them to make it out okay? In fact, hang on. Isn't this just Saw 2? Think about it. Saw 2 had a bunch of criminals all locked up in a one-down building being hunted by Jigsaw. The difference is those were at least interesting. These aren't. They're just disgusting douchebags who will want to die. And the other characters are just boring sheets of paper, so I have no interest in them either.
I thank you for that.
Meanwhile, Logan and his bird show up at the location because the barn was shut down due to some disease that they found in the system of one of the bodies. Again, we'll come back to this. But oh no, the detective has followed them there and is ignoring the calls as the cops find Jigsaw pieces in his freezer. If the twist were any more obvious, I would be blind.
The best ones are.
They find the first trap and begin to ponder how any of this is even possible.
It's Jigsaw.
Jigsaw is dead.
Is he?
Well, yes. A slit throat with a saw will probably do it.
Please. I'll do anything you want, John. Just please let me go.
Or I'll act a convincing emotion. But oh well, they find the new trap and Logan begins to question her before the detective shows up. Meanwhile, thanks to John speaking fluent cryptic, Anna thinks the key to freedom is killing Ryan but ends up dying herself. The key was in the bullet, lovely, I feel so bad. Meanwhile, Logan and the detective both get jumped and wake up with this crap around their neck. John's voice sounds out and admittedly, this is kind of funny.
Make your choice.
How are you alive? How are you still alive?
Of course, the detective double crosses him and pushes his button first, so Logan has to confess. He apologizes for messing up John's scans, but gets killed anyway. Now it's the detective's turn, who confesses to tampering with evidence, taking bribes, and letting murderers and rapists walk free. But now it's time for the dum-dum, super-super dum-dum-dum-da-dum-dum plot twist that we already saw coming! Yeah, that's right. Logan was Jigsaw this whole time. He planted John's blood, he swapped the bodies, he used John's voice, and the trap we've watched for the whole film was 10 years ago, before John was even infamous as Jigsaw, explaining why they don't know what's going on. But if Logan was doing all of this, why is it the woman who took him here? She was innocent. He admits he just used her as an alibi. But he left a lot of this up to chance. How would he know that she would figure out where the game was? How would he know she wouldn't suspect him? How would he know that she would want to take him there? How would he know that the detective would also follow them? How would he know the detective would double cross him first? None of this makes sense! And basically, Logan recreated the trap 10 years later, but this time-lapse bollocks was already done before in Saw 3 and 4. Logan was basically the asleep guy and John took him in and also trained him. So for those keeping score at home, Jigsaw had the help of Amanda, Detective Hoffman, Dr. Gordon, and now Logan, all from the start. Blow me! Fresh new material, you've retracked and done the same twist four times! You've recycled every goddamn thing!
Alright.
He basically wanted revenge because the dude at the start killed his wife and the detective let him go, but I just don't care for this character or his motive. And this exposition lasts an entire 5 minutes and then he gets killed anyway. Which again goes against Jigsaw's shtick. Oh, and the special effects look hilariously bad.
I speak for the dead.
And they didn't even end it with game over. And I know one of the other sequels didn't as well, and it was a problem then. They should always end with game over.
Look, the first seven aren't exactly perfect, and each of them have problems too, but I enjoy them, and almost every installment at least tried something new. The reason the whole Detective Hoffman and Agent Strahm made us care was because the movies actually developed on their feud and their characters. It also spread across a few movies. This one just doesn't focus on it at all, so when the obvious twist happens, you don't care, and it's not even consistent with anything else in this bullshit picture. The trailer made it look like Jigsaw was alive, and you know what? He should have been. Like Angry Joe said,
I almost would have had more respect for them if they did make up some bullshit to make him be alive.
Yes! Yes!
That's great!
That's what we fucking wanted! If they would have gone with the, like you said, resurrecting Jigsaw and being like, you know what, fuck it, he's back. Or, fuck it, go fucking satanic worshippers raise his dead body so that he can, they love and adore him so much because he's so creative, they want to bring him back. So they bring him back from the dead with the satanic ritual, and now you have satanic Jigsaw.
It would have been dumb, but at least they'll be self-aware. So, oh no, John didn't die, that was his twin. I don't know, something dumb, but at least be fuck it, they're alive. They could have just said, look, we know our films are already silly, so we're bringing them back. Deal with it. The only reason this film made so much money was because the trailers made it look like he was back and he wasn't. They lied to their audience and that's it. At least him coming back would have been different. But here, what was new? What was different? We went so many years without an installment, so when they came out with a new one, I expected something original, but they recycle absolutely everything. There is not a goddamn thing this film adds to the franchise whatsoever outside of his scan results being switched. In fact, Logan goes out of his way to find victims exactly like the ones 10 years ago to put them through the same traps to resemble the previous ones. But why? The bodies were never found! Why would he need to do any of this? And the barn belonged to John's wife, but they never found that out when questioning her in the previous movies? In fact, he copied every single death, including the guy who was asleep. But that was him! That was him 10 years ago! So why did he need to murder an innocent person? Why did he make it look like Jigsaw? He wanted to frame this guy, but John died 10 years ago! What was Logan doing since Saw 7 and now? Was he just chilling, looking back at his killing days? Why not just kill the detective and frame him? And how can you frame him as Jigsaw by putting him in a fucking Jigsaw trap? None of this makes any fucking sense! This movie is just a pointless, unnecessary cash grab. That's what it is. And I dread the next few installments.
Oh my god. I saw this in cinemas. I paid to see this shit.